This week on WealthTrack, in an exclusive interview, Wall Street's longtime number one investment strategist, Francois Trahan, explains why he has turned from market bull to bear. His controversial call and strategy are next on Consuelo Mack WealthTrack.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Thornburg Investment Management, Active Management, Flexible Perspective, Rosalind P. Walter, and the Fairholm Foundation.
Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. The U.S. has been the place to be for investors this year, even more so after the election of Donald Trump as president. Since November 8th, U.S. stock markets have been on a tear, extending their lead over international markets by a substantial margin. As a recent Wall Street Journal article pointed out, the global dominance of U.S. stocks has been boosted by the post-election rally and the strength of the U.S. dollar, which has also been appreciating rapidly against other currencies. The market capitalization of U.S. stocks reached over $25 trillion in December, comprising more than 40% of the world stock market value, levels not seen since 2006. No other country comes even close. Despite rapid gains in China's stock market size and value, for instance, it still has less than a 10% share of global market value. With low unemployment, corporate profits expected to pick up, and stimulus anticipated from infrastructure spending, corporate tax cuts, and regulatory rollbacks, more investors are jumping on the bullish bandwagon, which is why the message from this week's guest is such a stunner. In a WealthTrack exclusive, Wall Street's top-ranked investment strategist is saying it's time to put on the brakes and get much more defensive. He is Francois Trahan, co-founder, partner, and head of the portfolio strategy team at Cornerstone Macro, an independent macro research policy and strategy firm he and his partners launched in 2013. Trahan was recently inducted into the All-America Research Team Hall of Fame by Institutional Investor magazine, having been ranked the number one portfolio strategist for 10 of the past 11 years by institutional investors. Now, up until recently, Trahan was correctly bullish on the U.S. stock market, as he had been for well over a year. Well, no more. He is adamantly telling clients that this rally should be sold. I asked him why.
Every bear market starts from the peak of a bull market. You know, this business is about looking at what's in front of you. And at the beginning of the year, you know, when I think back to what our bullish story was about, it was really about one thing, and it was the belief that the economy was going to get better.
Right.
And it was very, very difficult to convince people at the time. The environment was very, very negative, and the data wasn't very good, mm-hmm. truth be told. Data was pretty bad. But when you looked in the rearview mirror, what you saw policy-wise was stimulus. If you looked at money supply, what you saw is that it had accelerated. You looked at the slope of the yield curve, it had steepened. Even banks had eased lending standards. You know, so all things that are associated with better data ahead. And so that was the one thing we needed for the bullish call and the risk-on call, if you will, to happen. And so February comes along, all of a sudden the leading indicators of the economy, you know, the PMIs start to turn up, and it started a slow revival of investor appetite towards things that are cyclical.
Right. Very slow.
Well, yeah,
right?
Very slow initially, yeah. And you know, there were a few bumps along the way. We had the big Brexit episode, which scared a lot of people. But at the end of the day, you know, something like that is scary, but if it doesn't change a trend in the data, it really ends up being noise on a trend. And so we really viewed Brexit as an unbelievable gift, you know, to the folks that weren't positioned cyclically at the beginning of the year. This was their opportunity to get in. You know, what concerns us about 2017 is that when we look at the state of policy now, what we see is a tightening of conditions. So the same indicators that told you the data was going to get better at the beginning of the year are now telling you that as we get into 2017, the data is going to start to slowly slip.
So which conditions are tightening? Because you've got a new president coming in who's going to have his foot on the fiscal stimulus accelerator. Isn't that a positive?
Well, sure, but none of that money will hit the economy in 2017, and the stock market can't discount that far. You know, at the end of the day, we're all speculating as to what will happen policy-wise.
Right.
But the hype is incredible, and people have convinced themselves of a lot of things, such as, that when we have a budget, the tax cuts will be retroactive. We think that's very unlikely to happen.
So you think that's what the market is discounting? That kind of extreme?
Absolutely.
Not just tax cuts going forward, but tax cuts that are retroactive.
Well, the last two times that we had big tax cuts with the Bush administration and before that with the Clinton administration, they were retroactive. Mm-hmm. But at that time, you were in recession. You needed to give the economy a bit of a jolt. You know, this time around, it's a lot more about reforming the tax code, and then trying to put money in people's hands very, very quickly. And so it's a different set of conditions. And so on paper, of course, fiscal stimulus can be a good thing. Mm-hmm. But when you sit down and think about it, it's very unlikely to have to play a role in the economy in 2017. Fiscal stimulus takes a long time to be deployed.
You mentioned tightening. Mm-hmm. What is tightening? Where are you seeing?
At this point,
issues.
Everywhere. So mm-hmm. every gauge of policy that we look at shows a tightening of conditions, whether it's money supply that had accelerated leading up to the beginning of the year has now slowed across the developed world. This is not just a U.S. story. We look at gauges of bank liquidity, like swap spreads, for instance, which had narrowed in the latter part of 2015, usually a great sign for the economy. It's a sign that liquidity is building, that it's about to be deployed, a sign that the data is about to have a bit of a go at it, if you will. Well, they have now begun to widen. We've had big changes in interest rates, of course, of late. And so every gauge of policy that we looked at the beginning of the year was telling us that consensus was looking at the wrong thing. And I would say it's the case again today. I would challenge the notion that the rally is about the election. And I realize I sound a little crazy because, we're being bombarded.
Well, the rally seems to have accelerated with the Trump election.
Is that coincidence or is that causality? So let me give you two examples. Mm-hmm. When we show a chart of the stock market to our clients, we often show it with the economic surprise index, which is a gauge of whether economists have an upside surprise to a data release, and so whether it's better than consensus or a downside surprise. So it correlates really, really well with the stock market, of course. So in the last month, the economic surprise index posted its biggest increase in 4 years. So we just had the friendliest data set for equities in 4 years. Mm-hmm. Now, when we plot a chart of treasuries, the 10-year treasury bond yield, the strongest correlation you'll find with the treasury market is with global leading indicators of the economy. The global PMI is the series that we like to use.
Purchasing Managers Index, right?
Purchasing Managers Index. Well, in the last 2 months, you just had the biggest two-month increase in 4 years. And so we're not
in the
used
PMI,
to,
in the, so that's
in the global
again,
PMI.
That's again, right. That's positive for the economy.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
Right.
And so if you didn't know there had been an election, and I told you, the economic surprise index just surged higher, biggest month in 4 years. Global PMI, on it, it turned a corner in July, just when bond yields started rising.
So what
and guess
happened
what? In the last two
Trump
months? You know,
Clinton.
Best results in 4 years. What would you tell me the stock market did? What would you tell me bond yields did? You would tell me the stock market went up and bond yields are up, and that's exactly what's happened. So I'm not telling you the elections didn't play a role here, but but it's not the primary driver of financial markets. It's contributing, it's a factor, but this is what you should expect when you have the best data you've seen in 4 years.
So the best data in 4 years.
That's right.
But the tightening conditions that you're seeing as well, so they're going to basically overcome the momentum of this data.
They're going to,
so, and mm-hmm. how significantly are they going to slow the economy's momentum?
Yeah. Well, when you have a surge in the stock market like this,
right?
The way you know whether it's a rally you want to participate in or fade mm-hmm. is by looking at the past state of policy, because it's policy that will tell you whether the data can be sustained. You know, again, the best data points in 4 years, whether they can be sustained or not.
Right.
And unfortunately, right now, gauges of policy argue that you're essentially at peak stimulus today. You got the best data because you essentially are digesting, you know,
right.
the biggest easing of conditions in the rearview mirror, if you will. And so from here, incrementally, every month, things start to change. We start to digest a tightening of monetary conditions. So, you know, the question becomes, can the Trump administration come up with a set of policies
right.
that can offset this
yes.
tightening of conditions? President-elect Trump is going to come into office at a time when there is a tightening of conditions in the pipeline. We're not talking about 300, you know, basis points and rate hikes here.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
If you look at the Treasury market, it is the equivalent to about, you know, 3 to 4 rate hikes. So it's not the end of the world, but it's not what you had going into this year where you had an easing mm-hmm. of conditions. And so at the margin, it's different. And it's also tightening in a world economy that has a lot of problems.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody's excited about the stock market going up. Everybody wants to talk about the tax cuts. People aren't necessarily talking about the risks that some of the proposed policies bring.
And what are the risks that you're concerned about? That again, it was a big call to say risk off from risk on in 2016.
Right.
So what are the risks that you're saying should make investors very cautious?
Sure. Well, I would say before we get there.
Right.
I'm not bearish because, you know, I think there's going to be a financial crisis somewhere in the world. I'm bearish because policy tells us the economy is going to slow,
mm-hmm.
and that means lower earnings estimates.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, right now, it also spells lower market multiples.
Mm-hmm.
PEs right now are behaving in a very unusual manner. And what I mean by that is that they're very, very cyclical. And that's not the typical state of affairs with market multiples.
And how are they cyclical? How are the PE
multiples,
price earnings multiples?
So, you know, historically, when you look at the S&P's PE, it tends to look like the inverse of inflation. So inflation goes up, PEs come down. Mm-hmm. Inflation goes down, PEs go up. That's why there's a lot of slowdowns historically. So, you know, the exact same picture I'm painting for next year, where the stock market goes up, not down, because slower growth hurts earnings,
mm-hmm.
but it brings about lower inflation,
mm-hmm.
and it helps PEs go up. So in a different context, you could say there's a silver lining to my story, which is that slower growth will lead to lower inflation, will help multiples go up. Unfortunately, PEs are not behaving like that. So right now, if you look at the S&P's forward multiple, what you're gonna see is that it looks a lot like a leading indicator of the economy. And so if you take the, you know, the conference board's official LEI,
mm-hmm,
or official
right.
leading economic indicator index
right.
and you look at the components, so it's things like building permits, initial jobless claims,
mm-hmm.
BAA credit spreads. If you plot those with the S&P's PE, you're going to see that they look exactly the same. So that means slower growth, lower earnings, lower PEs. So you don't have to think there's a recession coming to be concerned about stocks. When PEs are behaving this way, it means that any slowdown is going to give you a disproportional decline in the index.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I'm bearish.
You were mentioning earlier that we've got very strong data around the world with the Purchasing Managers Index. But you're also concerned about that there is some fragility in economies around the world and that could cause some real problems. So tell me about that. If the U.S. in fact slows, that could set off kind of a domino effect, right? In some
correct. Well, when you look around the globe, you know, there hasn't been a time like this, you know, possibly ever, where there's so many countries dealing with, you know, what we call structural issues, mm-hmm. longer term issues, and they're different. For, you know, Brazil is dealing with really a lot of debt and a budget situation. Japan's got demographics,
right?
You know, that are a drag to the economy. China's got overinvestment and, mm-hmm. You know, a lot of excess capacity. You know, what these countries have in common is that when you have something impeding demand in your economy, well, by default, you become much more dependent on other people's growth. Or in
especially
GDP
the U.S.,
talk,
right?
So that well, can, that's right. So right. In GDP talk, what we call exports.
Right.
When the U.S. economy slows, you know, because we are the biggest importer
yes.
in the world, it means that exports start to slow in all these places. So a U.S. slowdown exposes the weakest links around the world, if you will.
So, Francois, it is not easy to be a naysayer, to be bearish when we're in a bull market, right? You've been here before.
Yes. So I would say that this is the very late innings of the bull market. We're not bullish or bearish to try to be counter consensus. We're mm-hmm. bullish or bearish based on our view of the outlook of the future economy. And so it wasn't any easier being bullish at the beginning of the year, you know, than it is being bearish now with regards to 2017. Well, I shouldn't say that. Maybe it was a little bit easier, because the reality is our industry is really geared for a rising market, because there's
yes.
a lot more assets in long only strategies than you know, in market neutral strategies. So I think, you know, when you have a thesis to be bold enough to come out with a bearish thesis, you really have to believe it. You mm-hmm. really have to have high conviction in it. So I would say anyone who's willing to sit across from you, Consuelo, and paint a bearish story of the markets, you should pay attention to, because you really have to believe it to do that.
Right, which you do believe it. You're adamant about this. So what are you telling clients to do?
Well, we're telling them to use this opportunity, to use this phenomenal data and these very strong markets to position yourself for what lies ahead. And what our indicators tell us, what the state of policy tells us, is that in 2017, the data is going to start to slip. And so when the economy starts to slow, it means these really cyclical companies, the ones that have led the charge in recent months, mm-hmm. all of a sudden don't look so good. Investors.
So materials, industrials, financials.
About as good as it can be.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people, when the economy slows, gravitate towards stability.
So start trimming now before it turns really
correct.
Rapidly, which
mm-hmm.
it probably will, as it always does, right, on the downside. Or does
well,
it?
You know, the stock market and the data, the leading indicators of the economy
mm-hmm.
are pretty much the same thing. The S&P is actually one of the components
of the
Conference Board's
right.
official LEI, their leading economic indicator index. And so use the strong data, use this strength in cyclicals to sell at a profit
mm-hmm.
and to buy the stuff that is very unpopular. You're not buying it because it's unpopular. You're buying it because the economy is going to slow.
And so what are the kinds of things that you're telling clients to buy?
Well, from an asset allocation perspective, treasuries
mm-hmm.
are
are
very appealing here.
Uh-huh.
Absolutely.
Why? I mean, everyone else on Wall Street basically is saying, get out of treasuries. They're high risk.
Sure.
Interest rates are going up.
Mm-hmm.
The principal of treasuries is going to go down. So.
Yep. Well, again, leave consensus out of it.
Yeah.
What drives treasuries is the economy. If
mm-hmm.
you plot the 10-year treasury bond yield
mm-hmm.
with the global PMI, you can barely tell them apart. And so it's not about consensus. It's not about what everybody's saying. It's about whether you believe the economy can improve from here or whether you believe the economy is going to slow from here. And it's policy that helps you determine that.
Right. So if the economy does slow, so what's the sweet spot in the treasury yield curve? I mean, is it the 10-year? Is it the 5-year?
Well, the further out you go,
the more
leverage you'll get,
rate.
Of course.
Right.
And in the stock market, there's a lot of treasury proxies, and in, you know, the equity equivalent of treasuries is leverage. So mm-hmm. it's companies that hold a lot of debt mm-hmm. because when interest rates come down, all of a sudden that debt is less expensive to service, makes the earnings, of course, look better.
And of course, interest rates are still relatively low compared to historical norms, at least in the post-World War II era. How much can they come down?
You know, I feel like I heard that statement for the first time in 1998 when the 10-year Treasury bond yield, I think it was the first year where it went below 5%. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And so, and people have made it pretty much every year since.
Yes, they have.
And yet we had 0% 10-year bonds.
Right.
European economies earlier this year. Japan, of course, where I think the 10-year JGB was negative.
Negative at one point.
Negative.
Right.
So, if we retouch the lows, that's an incredible profit, particularly
yes.
if it happens at a time when the stock market's going down. You know, your opportunity cost is, do you want to lose 10%, 15%, 20% in a bear market? Remember, PEs are very, very cyclical here. And so you're in a world where bond yield and the stock market have a very strong inverse relationship, or bond prices, I should say, in the stock market. Utilities, telecoms, REITs, companies with a lot of debt are the ones that tend to do well when interest rates are moving lower.
Mm-hmm.
So those, they're obviously very unpopular investments right now, but those are the types of companies that we would encourage people to think about. You know, again, we're not talking just about the next 4 weeks or,
right.
month or two here. We're talking about the next year, as the slowdown gains traction, as people start to realize that fiscal stimulus will take a long time to gain traction in the economy. And at the end of the day, people always ask, what are my company's earnings going to do next quarter?
Mm-hmm.
That's that window that you got to worry about, the next 3 to 6 months.
One investment for a long-term diversified portfolio, what should we all own some of now?
So if we're thinking long-term, and again, you look around the world, you see all these countries that have these structural issues. You see consumers in the U.S. that are in deleveraging mode, essentially since the 08 crises.
Mm-hmm.
We're in a world of slower growth,
mm-hmm.
both domestically and internationally. And maybe fiscal stimulus will help that in 2018 for a little bit. But if we're thinking long-term, a world of slower growth means that you want companies that have some sort of longer-term story, some sort of what people call growth story.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so longer-term, I would say it's growth stocks that you want. It happens to be, I would argue, what you want anyways next year, because, again, we believe the economy is going to slow, and growth tends to do better than value. Right? Defense tends to do better than cyclicality when
mm-hmm.
the economy is slowing. So longer term, I would steer you in that direction.
Are you allowed to be any more specific than that? Or
not without a lot of disclaimers.
Yeah.
But I would say if you're able to think just cyclically and think about just the next 9 to 12 months, say,
mm-hmm.
I think you're being presented with an unbelievable opportunity in treasuries.
Mm-hmm.
I think this backup in bond yields is a great gift at the end of the year.
And that should last, this backup in bond yields, which means that the yields are going up, how extensive do you think it's going to be?
Well, if you believe the data is going to deteriorate in 2017, then bond yields are moving down, which means bond prices are going up.
Yes.
And so it's an opportunity to make an absolute return, even in a bear market in equities, which is a possibility next year.
Right. All right, Francois Trahan, really lovely to have you on WealthTrack.
Thank you.
So much.
Thank you for having me.
At the close of every WealthTrack, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point is consider adding some TIPS, or Treasury Inflation Protected Securities, to your portfolio. If, in fact, we are entering a period of higher inflation, even slightly higher, TIPS offer protection because their principal increases along with inflation, as measured by the Consumer Price Index. The flip side is, if inflation decreases, so will TIPS principal. Because of the shift in investor expectations from deflation to inflation, tips have gotten a bit more expensive, but they are still considered to be well within a reasonable range. You can buy them commission-free at auction directly from the U.S. Treasury or in fund or ETF form. They are safe, liquid, and offer diversification away from the stock market. Well, next week, we will talk to Rich Bernstein, a former top-rated investment strategist turned successful portfolio manager who has significantly shifted his strategy based on changing conditions. He'll tell us what they are and what he is doing. On WealthTrack.com, in our extra feature, we will ask Francois Trahan about the role behavioral finance is playing in his work. As always, we welcome your feedback by email or on Facebook and Twitter. Thank you for watching. Have a great weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Thornburg Investment Management, Active Management, Flexible Perspective, Rosalind P. Walter, and the Fairholme Foundation.